evening and welcome to Meticulous Moments. My name is Jonita Kapp. You can reach me at meticulousmacarons@gmail.com or find me on LinkedIn. Since the COVID-19 pandemic hit the globe, I've had the wonderful privilege to meet a wide array of fantastic individuals. These individuals have truly touched my life in so many positive ways. Amongst this group of people, there are authors, public speakers, life coaches, poets, leaders, and visionaries. They are the unsung heroes of our time. Therefore, I decided to start the Meticulous Moments movement out of a sense of my gratitude. It is my way of giving back to the community. Let us share and reshare their stories in an effort to build a better society. Good day, everyone, and welcome to Meticulous Moments, where we facilitate community upliftment through leadership development. And today, we have the wonderful privilege of spending time with the amazing Rico Nosuave. A little bit more about Rico. Rico Mangram is a Chicago native who started his career as a computer scientist. His next career adventure was as a professional salsa dancer and instructor, followed by creator of an event company focusing on weddings, which led to him writing a book called Rock, The Newlywed's Wedding. In 2018, Rico started producing his current talk show, The Rico Nosuave Show, and somehow, as if those accomplishments weren't enough, he found his passion for cooking and decided to produce and host a cooking show called Cooking with Rico. Currently, both of his shows are in negotiations with syndicated markets. My goodness, this was such a fun and enlivening session. Rico and I really dug deep into leadership and life in general, and it was just an amazing experience to spend this time with him. Sit back, relax, and enjoy Rico Nosuave. And with that, we say welcome to our very special guest, Rico Nosuave. Good evening, Meticulous Moments audience. Thank you for joining us for yet another enlivening session here on the Meticulous Moments podcast, where we facilitate community upliftment through leadership development. And today we have the wonderful privilege of spending time with the amazing Rico Nosuave. Welcome, Rico.
What's up, everybody? Let's go. Let's go. Yes, I am here. How you doing? Juanita? How you doing?
I'm doing so well, Rico. I'm just loving this energy that we share. You know, it's been like that from the beginning. I just love the vibe you bring. And I was very fortunate to meet you through Israel Mandrake, a very close friend of ours. And I'm very excited to have you on the show. Now, we've talked on Messenger. We've had a virtual coffee. And I feel like, you know, we just clicked from the beginning. And I know you. I feel like I know you well now. But for the audience members who are not acquainted with you yet, would you like to introduce yourself to them, please?
Of course. Hey, everybody. My name is Rico Nosuave. I'm from the Rico Nosuave Talk Show. And I am, you know, a talk show host, and I am hyper. I just want to let you guys know that. That's just me. I'm a hyper person, but I'm also a positive person. I love as far as talking to people, and I'm honored to actually be here on Meticulous Moments as far as with Juanita Kapp. So I am happy to be here. And also, I've been doing kind of like an MC, but my talk show, I've been doing that going on 5 years now. So as far as an MC, I've been like talking, public speaking, but also doing events for over 15 years. So I'm really happy about, you know, being able to go into the industry of being a talk show host for TV.
My goodness, I know. I mean, you have been in this so long. You are a salted host. You know, you've been there, you've done that, you've had the experience, and I love the joy that you bring. I'm absolutely amazed. You know, every time we connect, it's just like uplifting and edifying. So I want to ask you, with regards to your journey, you know, you're a TV and radio show host. Would you like to tell us more about your journey? You've been in it for 15 years and the other 5 years that you are busy with.
Yeah. So, you know, when becoming an MC, it's funny. I was just talking to somebody about this recently in regards to saying, hey, how did you become an MC? So, yes. You know, becoming an MC, you know, it happened naturally. It wasn't like I was studying for it or, you know, as an MC, sometimes you have to study for it because the connection with people is very important. So it basically comes from when I was teaching. I teach dance classes. So I teach Shasha. And one of the things is that when I went to go and teach for one of my friends in a wedding here in Glenview, Illinois, yes. Big shout out to my man, Miguel. He said, hey, I want you to come and actually be my party starter and do a salsa class. I said, okay, no problem. So that was around, I think it was like 2008, I would say, around 2008. And he was like, yeah, you know, I want you to hype them up and get them going. I said, okay, well, I do that in my classes already. So, yeah. You know, a fun thing to be able to do. So to make a long story short, you know, I actually went there, did the class. Everybody was having a great time. And then the DJ was like, hey, have you ever thought about doing weddings? And I'm like, how? He was like, have you ever thought about, you know, teaching classes, but also being an MC? And I was like, I thought it to myself. I'm like, no, I never thought about it, but it seems like that would be pretty cool to do because I'm always in front of people. So he was like, well, check this out. I think you should actually try to be an MC because you have the voice for it and you'll be able to, you know, make people laugh and joke and also keep the program going. So I was like, you know, I'm going to try it.
Yeah.
So I was like, you know, I'm going to actually try and get, you know, a DJ. And then we're going to try and do our first wedding together. So one of my good friends, his name is DJ Mambo, rest in peace. But DJ Mambo, he actually said, hey, yeah, I'll do it with you. Let's do our first wedding together. I said, okay. So I did a wedding, and I think my guy was Polish, and she was from Mexico. And yeah. It was my first time doing a wedding as an MC. When I first did it, Juanita, I tell you, I was nervous, but then it was like 60 people in the audience. It wasn't a big one. It was kind of like 60, yeah. maybe 60 to 70 people in the audience.
Yeah.
But my thing was, I said, okay, I need you to treat this as if it was a salsa class. When you talk to people, talk to them and look around the room. Because that's what I do. I look around the room, looking at my people, my class. I make a connection. Then it was all about music, right? For me to be able to talk with the music of introducing, you know, the bridal party and introducing the newlyweds and then start breaking it down and start introducing like the cake cutting, their first dances, the toasting and all that stuff. Now, of course, being organized as I am, me being also in IT made a big difference. So what I did was I had it all broken down. So I'm like, I had the paper and I'm like shaking the paper because I think people knew I was nervous because I was shaking the paper. And I'm and they knew it. And I'm like, I had the, and then, you know, once it started flowing, I asked my dad, man, so how did I do? He's like, man, you did good. You did awesome. You know, just keep doing what you're doing. And then the wedding couple's like, oh my God, it was amazing. They had a great time. And I'm like, woo, right? From then on, it's been good. And I've been doing weddings back to back. It started practicing. Beautiful. I started connection with people. And then that's when it came to me being a talk show host. How did that start? I would say maybe 4 or 5 years ago, of course, 4 or 5 years ago, someone asked me at a wedding, hey, how did they get you? One of the people from the audience was like, hey, how did they hire you as far as to be an MC? And I was like, you know, they looked me up on, you know, this lead board and they found me and then I had to meet with them and they was like, oh, you're the one. They say, wow, I thought you was from like a radio or TV show. I'm like, really? They're like, wow. Yeah. I was like, no. And then that was the first time, right? Then the second time happened. Juanita, the second time happened. Then like, somebody asked me again, are you the same thing? I'm like, were you just at this other wedding that I was just at? Because somebody just asked me. And then all of a sudden, it was like, no, but you should have your own talk show. I'm like, all right. It happened again the third time. So, you know, three times, you know, it's like, wow. Three times, gotta do it.
Yeah.
So three times after that, somebody asked me, say, hey, would you like to, you know, be on, you know, you should be on the talk show. It's like, okay. But the weird thing about the universe is how things happen for a reason. And
this
other gentleman asked me to be on his station, and as from a radio standpoint, just to be audio only. So they can't see my face, it's just audio. So I started doing that as far as with audio, and I started to like it. And I was actually talking, playing music, and it was audio. I was like, okay, I like this. So that didn't work out. So I was like, I'm in my zone now. I'm like, the three people that just asked me to that you should have your own talk show, you should go ahead and do it. So I made up my mind to be able to start that in 2018 with my co-host Valerie Malesio, which she was also my dance partner. So Valerie was also my dance partner back in
the day.
And she's like, I said, I'm about to start my own talk show. She's like, yo, I'm there with you. I'm like, yo, okay. So we started the Rico No Suave. So the Rico No Suave show, the reason why we started the Rico No Suave show, because that's always been my name when I did, you know, like inspirational things, like in my car, when I'm driving, do lives. And then I took it to that next level and said, you know what? I'm going to patent this name, Rico No Suave Talk Show. I'm going to make sure it's incorporated. I want to make sure nobody else takes that name, because that's going to be mine. And then from then on, it's been the Rico No Suave.
I love it. I absolutely love it. I feel your personality, you know, the excitement that you bring. And I have to say, the universe was definitely at work bringing those people across your path to give you the idea, you know, to do the Rico No Suave show. And you fit, it fits you like a glove. It's who you are, you know, you bring upliftment and you just, it's amazing. It's amazing to see that. And I had to chuckle when you were mentioning the paper that was shaking, because I thought back to myself when I was young in the ministry. A pastor came to me and he said, I should do the worship one Sunday. And they gave me a microphone, but it wasn't on a stand. And I was so nervous the whole time I sang, my hand did this. So I'll never forget that. My hand was going like this and I was singing, but I couldn't let my hand stop shaking. So I know how you felt.
So I was kind of like that on my first wedding, because I had the paper in one hand, I had the microphone in the other hand, so I'm like this.
I'm so happy there's other people that also had a similar experience, so thank you for that. Really, that really made me chuckle. I love that. Now, you've seen it all. I mean, I'm sure you've met a lot of different people, different personalities, different backgrounds. And that's what you and I love. You know, we love to engage and network and just get to know people. Tell me about the life lessons or lessons that you've learned in your years, in the last few years that you've been working with people extensively.
You know, one of the things about people is how to engage them in a conversation. Some people will say, yes, I love to be on your show. I would love to come on your show. But they're nervous. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when it comes to how do I get them to say more than five words, right, as an answer. And the thing about being having, I should say, building your talent as a talk show host, it's being able to ask questions, but also to be able to get them comfortable. It's almost like you have to be a psychiatrist, right? Like a psychiatrist or a therapist, and you say, hey, so tell us about how, as an example, tell us how you became a musician. What was it about that made you start? And a person will come back and say, well, it was, you know, my dad got me into music, and yeah, that was it. And then as a talk show host, you're like, okay, there has to be more with you that you have to do in order for you to be able to, you know, get it out. So when you're at those moments, a lot of things come just beyond humans, right? And just beyond as far as your brain. But also it comes to a fact of how you as a person need to be able to have that conversation to get them a little bit. Because what happens is that If I had crickets in my studio, crickets, I had crickets in my studio, anything that made noise when you asked that question. So how did you become a musician? So the person will be like silent just for a little bit, and then we're silent. And it's like almost as if the camera's on our face, the camera's on their face, and it's the camera, who's going to say something next? And then you hear crickets, and then all of a sudden the person says, oh, it's just down to me. He just asked me a question. Oh, my father, you know, taught me how to actually use an instrument and go from there. Well, you know, my father, I grew up with music. And then after that, the camera gets back to your face and crickets. And then all of a sudden, when you got crickets going, you're like, okay, so what instrument did you play as a kid? Oh, well, I actually played the congas and I also played the timbales. Crickets. And it's like, okay, well, what made you want to play the drums? So what I'm saying, as of course you would know, that as you ask those questions, you're building up confidence for the person to be able to say more, right? And that was kind of the thing as far as a life lesson journey, as far as for me to be able to say, hey, when I ask these questions, we're going to freestyle on these questions. We're going to let you know that, hey, these questions are for you, and we're going to just thrive off of that question. Yeah. Or we're going to actually say, hey, if there's multiple questions I have to freestyle in between that, then, you know, that's what we got to do. So, yeah, that's a lesson learned for me.
My goodness, I can relate completely. I mean, sometimes there are guests that give very short answers, and it's really a skill to get them to open up and to ask the right, you know, to kind of guide them to bring the answer to the table. So that's definitely a life lesson, absolutely. And it's something that helped us grow. Because I've had similar experiences, it helped us grow. So thank you so much for that lovely, lovely answer. Now, I remember we had a lovely virtual coffee, and it was the same energy, you know, that we are having here this afternoon, this evening. Yeah. Anna, you mentioned something. You said you love to look for wonderful gems of people around the world that you can highlight, people that you can uplift. And I thought that was just, you know, phenomenal. I've never heard anyone phrase it like that. And I love to get to the reason why people do things. I always call it getting to the good stuff. And that really touched my heart. How do you facilitate that? How do you go looking for these wonderful gems?
So one of the things is that, you know, we talk about connections, we talk about networking, right? And it also comes from your show. Like, your show is your impression of what the world should be able to see. And one of the things is that if you're able to get someone of a gem, they're going to tell someone else in regards to their in-person experience, either in-person experience or their experience in general, as far as being interviewed. It takes a lot of experience, but also takes a lot of expression in regards to gratitude, and also to be able to have someone appreciate them being on the show. So when I go and look, like, at first it was LinkedIn, right? LinkedIn was all about business, but also I was looking for different lawyers, different doctors, and looking at certain people that was doing different things. Not your same, like, hey, I'm a family physician, or a lawyer that was just, you know, against criminals, or actually that was for criminals. It was more of, if I'm a lawyer, okay, what type of lawyer are you? Oh, you know what? The child support system. Oh, that's good. Come on to the show. And what happens is that it's kind of what people have been actually asking questions about versus to someone that already knows the answer. So when I'm looking for the gems around the world, I also look for musicians, right? Musicians, of course, when I look for, you know, R&B, rap, Latin, also, you know, people that has been actors, actresses. I'm looking, of course, for those big name people, which, you know, people have been actually being able to say, hey, you need to get onto this person's show. Oh, I got somebody that's going to be awesome to be on your show. But see, it's the connection that we have for these gems that we keep shining. And as long as we continue to shine, we're all going to shine together, because most of the celebrities, they just want you, like what we're doing right now. They just want to talk. They want to tell you about their world. They want to tell you about their journey. And then once you talk to them about their journey, it's just like, hey, this is a good conversation. I want to come back on this show multiple times. And I think that's how I find my gems of the world.
Absolutely love that description. Thank you so much. I love looking into, you know, your life and the way you think and the way you do things, because you are such a vibrant person, and that is really contagious. And I love to learn from people, you know, that are out there and that do things differently, because I find life is interesting. There's so much to discover. So thank you so much for facilitating that in me as well. I appreciate that. Thank you. Now, you're mentioned welcome. That Valerie is your dance partner. She's your TV show co-host. How did you meet?
So I met Valerie actually in the club. It was actually in a dance club. So it was through a mutual friend of ours, and I met her, and we actually, you know, we just vibe. Like, our vibe was just there. And then when she was actually dancing, she, you know, I asked her, if I'm going to say, I said, hey, you know, we had, you know, a dance company called Hot on One Salsa. Would you like to be a part of it? Right. And she's like, yeah, of course. But we've danced before, and we've, like, in the clubs, you know, like back in the day where, you know, break dancers, they would break dance and then there would be a circle. Well, that's how it was in the salsa scene as well, too, in Chicago. There used to be a circle and everybody used to dance and everybody used to be putting on shows and things like that. So we were doing that, right? We were doing, but it was naturally being done. So, you know, of course, over the time of knowing her for quite some time, when I told her about the talk show piece, it was like, she loves to talk, right? She loves to talk. She loves to express herself, right? And I think, and she's also very good with, you know, asking great questions. Because that was me and her. Like, we would freestyle off of certain questions, or we would freestyle on dancing. Like, we would practice one day and we'd just come up with all of these crazy moves. And I'm like, it was a connection of being able to say, hey, these dance moves are going to be basically turned into questions. Because we were basically kind of like, I'll ask certain questions and she'll ask certain questions. And it was like, wow, it was just like, the connection was just there. So when I asked her as far as to be onto the show, or I mentioned the show, she was the first one to say, hey, I want to ride with you on this one. This is going to be good, because we love to joke, we love to laugh, but we also are, we know how to tone it down to basically come to a serious level for the guests to understand that we care, but we also want to make sure that you're happy and hyped on the show as well. So yeah, that's how we met.
Absolutely. I see you guys being in flow. You know, it just works. You bounce off each other and it just works. And there's just this flow. And I'm sure that is also what makes your show, you know, so amazing and what attracts people to it, because they feel that harmony. Yeah. They feel that unity there. Now, I wanted to ask you the following. I mean, you've achieved so much in life. And I spoke with you and, you know, I saw that you're an authentic and a very humble person. And I found that amazing, because I've worked with people from all arenas in life. And sometimes when they get to a certain place or a certain level, it does change for them. And, you know, they are more towards maybe, what can I call it? Maybe they are elevated a little bit or more professional. And they change a little bit in their character. But you are so refreshing. I mean, you're a breath of fresh air, because when I met you, you are established, you are successful, you've achieved so much, and still you are humble and authentic and easy to talk to and open. And I wanted to ask you, how did you stay, you know, humble and a lovely person like you are? Because it can't be easy, you know, to stay grounded.
Sure, sure. I mean, that is a question that I answer a lot. And I love to answer this question, because it's. I always tell people there's a difference between confidence and arrogance. There's
a difference. Beautiful.
When you're humble, it's good to be humble and have confidence in what you love to do.
Yeah.
But then when you get to the arrogant level, it's almost like you got up to that level where you don't know the people below you. Yeah. And you how to communicate to those people via body language, but also being able to talk to them, right? As far as in general conversation. And I think being humble takes you to that level of staying grounded, staying like continuously reading and also looking at YouTube videos to be able to impress, try to help impress yourself. When I say impress yourself, that means for you to get better. Impress yourself by doing different things. Also, it also helps you stay in, you know, how can I say it? Different cultures have different ways of living, right?
Oh, yes.
And when you understand other cultures, you tend to know exactly how to be able to respect them, to be able to talk to them, and be able to know that, hey, if I happen to go to another country or if I happen to go to another state and there's different, let's just say there's a section of Ukrainian, right? And I'm like, oh, I got some Ukrainian friends. I love to talk to them, right?
Yeah.
And then I know go into that group and be able to talk to them, but also to be able to have that humble. And if they ever came to me and say, hey, Rico, can I get your autograph? I'm like, of course, let's take a selfie, beautiful, right? And then it's more of how you continuously be original, right? Be authentic, but be different from, you know, getting up to that level. Now, of course, when there's so many people, of course, if they're in front of you or talking to you, you try not to disrespect anyone, right? You want to make sure you like it. But if there's so many people, you can't help but continue to walk through it and be like, hey, I'm sorry that I missed all you guys, but hey, I'm just going to give you a wave. Good to see you guys. But, you know, when it comes to stuff like this, it's like staying humble is, it also comes with, you know, ups and downs.
Yeah.
Ups and downs, right? You have your bad moments, you have your good moments, you have your meticulous moments too, right? So one of the things about up and down, you know, it keeps me grounded, right? One day I'm happy as a cloud 10, right? A cloud with shapes of elephants and tigers, right? Then you have those downfalls where it's like, okay, the clouds are dark right now. I'm going through a little bit of a storm, right?
Yep.
And I'm like, okay, I got to continue to work, or I just need to sleep this off. I need to go to bed. I know today is not going to be a good day. I'm just going to sleep and just wake up in the morning and say it's a brand new day, right? And, you know, sometimes it's hard to smile through when you're going through problems. And I think staying humble keeps you that way, right? And I think that those ups and downs, everyone goes through them. And then sometimes people feel alone, right? Sometimes people feel alone, but it's good that I always have people that I can actually talk to, like yourself, to be able to say, hey, you know, it's a new day, let's get it. So that's what keeps me humble.
Beautiful answer. I absolutely love the way you articulated that. And I agree with you wholeheartedly. There's a difference between having confidence, that's what we have, and between being arrogant. And the way that you approach life, I find it very, very interesting. And we can learn from that because you've been through the, you know, the ropes and you've been through the experience and still you've kept that humility. And that's what people enjoy. People don't want plastic. They don't want fake. They want authenticity. They want the real us. You know, even when we have a chuckle, it's good because people want to, they want to relate to us. So I think you do that to the T. Absolutely fantastic.
Thank you.
I was going to ask you, you know, with project management, you need strong leadership abilities. You need a discipline. How do you facilitate that?
So one of the things about, I was kind of referring to my IT. So I'm in IT as well too. So I'm a senior network engineer for a hospital here in Chicago. And I've been an engineer for over 15 years. But one of the things about being an engineer from a network, from IT, is everything has to be a process. Everything has to be broken down into pieces.
Yeah.
So it also comes with the connection of me actually doing weddings and also for quinceañeras and also doing big events, because everything is based off of a timeline. I have that. And that's my timeline. My timeline is that if I know that I have a project coming up, okay, when do we need to set up time where we can plan? And then once we plan, we iron everything out as far as that plan. We put a timeline together in regards to what we're going to do for that specific day. Mm-hmm. I do that for my talk show every week. Every week, I know what questions I'm going to actually have. I know what time the commercials are going to actually come on. And then I know exactly what segments that we actually need to do after our talk show. So I have that every week, keeping that project or projects calendars, right? You got to have a calendar, right? Calendars are are your best friend. I mean, that alerts you when you know you have something coming up the day before, just in case if you forgot. That alert should pop up and say, hey, okay, you got an interview with Juanita Cat. All right, make sure you're ready. Yay. Okay, let's go. And then, you know, you have, you also have people that will call you and say, hey, we just, you follow up just to make sure this whole thing is going. Now, project sometimes is based off of who you're working with, right? Sometimes some people are not organized. And when they're not organized, it makes it hard. It makes it hard. So, and when people are not organized, it's because either they forget or they like, oh man, I forgot all about that. Let's say, for example, like for interviews, right? Yes. Each interview, when I book someone, is a project.
Yes.
I look forward to actually getting to that day, wrapping up that day, because I need this information. I know exactly what questions I'm going to actually have. We're going to continue to plan. We're going to say, hey, do you need anything else from me? These are the normal projects that you will actually go through just to make sure when the day finally comes that it's perfect, right?
Yeah.
You know, when it comes to projects like that, it's so, you want it to be a meticulous moment, right? I love using that word. I don't know. I'm sorry. I'm just using that word. I love that word. But you have to use that. You have to use those meticulous moments in order for you to be able to continue to, you know, have a great time at what you're doing for that project. Serious moments and happy moments, right? And that's definitely how I keep my projects going.
Fantastic, fantastic. And every project is so unique. And every person and individual, you know, I've met so many people over, I think we are on episode 78 already, that I've edited and posted this week. And every single person, there was something just different about them, something just beautiful. And yes, it is a project because we really bring out the beauty of these people and the strong points. And when they get so vulnerable with us, you know, about their lives, that really speaks to the audience. So I loved your answer. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And, you know, as leaders, you work with many leaders. They face disappointments. Sometimes they internalize those disappointments. I've had many people tell me that if they failed, they felt like the failure. And I always tell them, you shouldn't confuse, you know, the project with who they are, because sometimes they just need to tweak their plan or maybe get other people on board as well. So how would you describe an answer to if leaders face disappointments? How do you think, or how would you advise them to deal with disappointments? Because we all face them from time to time.
Okay, so let me tell you how I fight failure. I don't fight failure with a smile. Sometimes people say, hey, you need to fight it, you need to smile it off and just keep going. That's not me. I fight failure with a sad face. And when I actually have a sad face, it bothers me. When it comes to technology, say, for example, I'm about to get started with my talk show, then all of a sudden there's a technology failure. There's something that happens with the technology and we don't start until 15 minutes later. To me, that's a failure. That to me, I know it's a failure, but it's not, sometimes it's out of our hands, right? But it's still a failure because people don't know what's happening in the background. They just know that you're late, right? And that failure piece will be in my head because I know that's something I have to fix. I'm not a person that if I know that there's something that went wrong, I'm going to be sad about it. I'm going to be sad about it, but I'm actually in the back of my head and say, how can I fix that right away? I don't let it sit. I don't let it sit at all. I fix the problem right away because the next following week, when I come back, it needs to be perfect. Now, that can go from whoever you're working with within the team. If they fail, you fail as a leader, right? Because they actually should know this is what they need to do their job. But you as a leader have to be able to tell them, hey, this cannot happen again. This is the reason why this cannot happen again, because there's only certain meticulous moments that we actually have that we need to make sure that you are on point with what we're actually doing to make this a successful event, right? So I take it as, you know, from a leadership standpoint, I take it as a failure of, yes, I'm going to have my head down. I'm human. People are human. When people actually have something that's sad, they kind of put their head down. But I put my head down for a reason because I know I got to lift my head back up with a purpose. And that means that I have to make sure that as soon as I find out what that failure is, that's going to be in the back of my head. And I have to be able to know how to be able to fix that if that ever comes up again.
I agree with you. I'm the same. You know, sometimes there are technical difficulties and it's out of our hands. And you and I, we are the type of person we want to streamline and make everything beautiful because we want to present a perfect product. So I love the way that you handle that. And yes, I also, you know, when things go wrong, the next time I'm like, what can I do for this not to happen in future? So I love the strategy that you have and your outlook. And I'm sure that your team also enjoys that because they know, you know, you want to, you strive for excellence. So that's just amazing.
That's right. Yes.
Now, we've all seen a display of leadership before. I mean, you've been in corporate. I've been in corporate all my life. We've been in different areas of arenas of fields of study. What was the best display of leadership that you ever saw, that you ever witnessed?
So one of the things is that I love to teach. So I always talk, I take the IT standpoint of things because there's always somebody that's, so I'm a senior network engineer and there's junior network engineers. So there's three levels of it. Sorry, there's a senior network engineer, there's a network engineer, and there's a junior network engineer. One thing as far as being able to provide leadership is to be able to know that when the juniors are actually going through what you have gone through, you have to be able to help train them to be able to get to that level of that certain level of excellence that we talk about, right? The excellence in regards to saying, hey, if you're trying to get to this level, here's what you have to do. You have to grind. You have to hustle. You have to make sure that you are on top of it all the time. When questions come to you, you got to know how to troubleshoot them. If you have a problem, don't forget to ask. Sometimes people, as leaders, we tend to keep things to ourselves, or juniors, I should say, or people that's coming up in the industry. They want to keep this in this bubble here. And when they keep it in a bubble, remember, the only time that this bubble is going to actually pop is only when you open it up to be able to ask those questions. But they also could pop with you failing, meaning that, well, I should have asked the question before I failed, because I'm trying to impress my manager, or I'm trying to impress this leader so they can know that they have faith in me to be able to do the job right. We're human. Things are going to happen. You might have to ask those questions because that's why you have leaders there to be able to guide you, to be able to help you to become successful at what you're doing. Now, of course, as a leader, you don't give all of the answers. You give some of them, but you don't give them all, because you got to let the person be able to get used to the strategy. They got to get used to the moments of, how do I fix things? How do I, you know, if it's broke, how do I fix it? If it's fixed, how do I not break it? Right. And it goes from that standpoint of leadership. I also talk about leadership when it comes to confidence. We talk about the confidence and arrogance, and how do we get to that level of being able to become that leader to be able to say, hey, we know that this person stands out because this person is working around the clock. This person doesn't get any sleep. I don't know why this person doesn't get any sleep, but they should take some melatonin or something. They got to get some sleep. Right. So and then they should be able to make sure that there are not, they got to have friends. Right. They have to have a life balance. You got to have friends. You got to have something. If you don't have that, leaders will basically tell you, hey, you got to have a life balance in order for you to get there. So,
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And you mentioned the word, and that word caught my attention immediately. You said you should troubleshoot. And I love that word, because you will know in troubleshooting, there's more than one way to solve a problem.
That's right.
And yeah, because I mean, for a long time in the corporate world, you know, from the companies that I worked with and did leadership training with, there was this odd conception that if you or preconception that if you have a problem, there's only one way to solve that problem. And I've been trying for years to instill it in people that there's always a different way. There's always various ways of solving problems. So thank you for using that word. That caught my attention, and I agree with everything that you've said. So working with teams, I mean, it's always going to be interesting. And we keep learning.
That's right. Troubleshooting humans is what we do. We troubleshoot humans.
I love that, troubleshooting humans. Yes. My goodness. Yeah, that's the only, that's lovely. I love that. That's the only way, legal way to shoot them is to troubleshoot. Oh my goodness. I want to ask you, Rico, what are some of the things that you like to do when you have some free time? You mentioned balancing your schedule. I mean, you are very busy and you made time for me today on a Saturday. So what do you like to do in your free time?
I like to fish. I'm a fisherman. So I love fish. Yeah, I love to fish. I'm man, I've been fishing ever since I was 7 years old. When my father, you know, actually told me to take a stick, a branch.
Love
it. You ever seen those kids? You ever seen like those like cartoons where they actually have a stick and there's like a little like they're about to move, about to go out of the town, and then they have this little hanker clothes in it. That's what I felt like when I was actually fishing. Right, I had the stick. And then I wrapped string around it. And then I had this little bobber. Then I had the hook. And then I had the weight. And the string was pretty long. The string was pretty long because it wasn't automatic. So my father said, hey, you need to actually learn how to do things manually. So, so I took the weight. And he said, I want you to throw as far as you can. Now, me being 7, 8, I only had little arms. So I couldn't throw it that far. So what I did was I threw it as far as I can, and it was like shallow, right? It was like, and he said, you have to wait. I said, okay. So he told me to wait. I said, what am I waiting for? He said, you have to wait to see if the bobber, if the bobber is going to go under the water. If the bobber goes under the water, that means a fish is biting the bait. So you're saying that I have to hold this pole or I have to hold the stick and I have to wait and see if the bobber goes down. If the bobber goes down, what do I do? He said, what I want you to do is I want you to take that stick and I want you to bring that in. Like, use the string and I want you to bring it in. So that's how I learn how to fish. So when I learn how to fish that way, okay, all right, I'm liking this because it's teaching me patience over time. Oh man, a lot of patience in regards to fishing. You can wait the whole day for one fish and you might be mad, but you wait one, you know, get one fish for the whole day. That's not a good fish fry. So you have to basically wait. And then sometimes you'll throw that in, they'll bite, you pull them in, you're like, I got a fish. Most exciting moment ever, right? So that's why I'm a fisher. Love fishing. What else do I like to do? I love bowling. I like bowl. I love arcade games. I love PS4, Call of Duty. I like playing those games as well. What else do I like to do? Of course, I told you I love dancing. Dancing is good. It's always good for good burning calories. You know, it's always good as well. I like to travel. Of course, I love to travel. Travel is good. Travel is always good. So I need to go to Africa, right? And now that I know why I need the cap, I need to go to Africa. Yep. Right? I need to check it out. Right? And that's what I really like to do, man. I like to do different things. I mean, you know, I like movies. I'm a movie buff. Yeah, so I like that as well. But those are the things I like to do on my spare time when I do have that spare time.
Beautiful, beautiful. You have such a zest for life, you know. You like different things, and different aspects about those things. You love to fish, And that is something that you patient. So those are the days where you sit next to the river and you just fish and enjoy. But you're also, you know, busy and vibrant and vibey and musical and you dance. And so I like that you're a very interesting and colorful person. And of course, I mean, you know me now, so you have to visit South Africa. Absolutely.
Yes, I had to get that plane ticket. Yeah, I got to do that. I like that.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now, I want to ask you, if you could spend a day with any leader, wow, who would that be and what would you do to pass the time?
Oh, man. That's a very good question, because there's a lot of great leaders that's out there. Yeah. There's a lot of them. I would definitely say, oh, man. I like Tony Robbins. Tony Robbins is pretty. Is really like Tony Robbins. I like Tony Robbins because he really thinks, his number one, his voice is powerful, right? Mm. When he talks. I like him because he understands as far as the ups and downs, and he finds certain ways to be able to help you understand things a different way than you're thinking. And that's what I like about Tony. So if I was able to sit down and talk to Tony in general, I would just talk about everything. Like I wouldn't even talk about hard things in life. I would just sit down and talk to him, ask him what he likes to do. Like, do you like the golf? Do you like the bowl? Do you like the fish? I like to just sit down and just talk to him about that, because knowing that he's actually doing things to be able to help people, you know, it's always cool to be able to say, hey, what do you like to do? Like, let's go hang out, bro. Let's go and play some basketball or something. Let's do something outside of the realm. I think I would spend my day, instead of trying to talk to him about certain things that I need to work on, because I can pick up your book. You know, I can pick up an audio book and you can just tell me then. But I would love to. And, you know, also what I would love to do is I would like to be on stage with him and be able to talk about a subject to be able to address the audience. I would love that. Yeah, that would be really
amazing. My goodness, can you imagine you coupled with Tony Robbins on a stage? I mean, that would be the show of a lifetime. That would be amazing. You would work so well together. Hey, what did you say? Just repeat that.
I'll be the jokester.
Well, he will enjoy that. He will enjoy that. And yes, he is. He's got this powerful, you know, way about him and that voice. I also follow him. I follow him on LinkedIn and I agree with you. But to put you two together, that would be an interesting day, Erica. It would be amazing.
That'd be crazy. Yeah, I think it would be crazy just for me and him to get together and just, you know, just hang out, but also just go ahead and do other things as well too, you know, and being on the stage, different level.
Wow. Yeah, that would be lovely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, you're busy with your TV show, you love to dance, you're busy with different various things, you're training leaders, you have your team. Yeah. What is next for you? What is next on the horizon for you?
So one of the, I got hired by Heart of Hollywood magazine. So of course I'm that celebrity talk host for Heart of Hollywood magazine. Big shout out to Giovanna Salas and also to my agent as well, Beatrice Davis. She's phenomenal lady. And one of the things that I love about the upcoming projects is being able to do things with certain musicians, but also to be able to go and start getting onto the red carpet. So the red carpet in 2023, that's where I'm going next. We definitely have to get there and working on different projects with different artists, producers, directors, producers, musicians. That's on the horizon now. That's coming up. That's going to be pretty big for me. We're going to be traveling a little bit next year as well. So we got our schedule that's going to be open for us to be able to make ends meet. And hopefully you'll be able to see more on TV. So that's going to be good.
Well, I see it happening. I absolutely see it happening. My friend, you are on the right track, and you know, just yes, your love for life and your love for people, those are the things that's going to pave the way for you. So from my side here, all the way in South Africa, I'm going to be following you on social media, and I'm going to be cheering you on.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that. And all the love to you and what you're doing for the meticulous moments. You know, I have to say that, you know, having conversations like this, just it brightens my day. You know, it brightens my day because we need more of this, right? We need more of the good conversations, but also just understanding life, you know, understanding life between two people, right? And I think that helps out a lot. You know, it helps us stay strong too. It helps us stay young too.
I'm so happy to hear that. I mean, I would love to stay young. We'll stay young together.
There you go. We gotta stay young. We gotta stay young because these moments are very real.
You know, they say time flies when you're having fun. And I'm looking at, you know, my screen here, and I see that we are literally down to the last question. The last hour has just flown by.
I like that. That means we're doing something right. Imagine if I was just to give you short answers and we have crickets. We're going to have a long hour.
Yeah, imagine I ask you what you like to do, and you were like, no, I like to fish. It was lovely. And of course, here in South Africa, we have our own crickets on hand because, I mean, you should hear the nightlife. I'll send you some.
I should have picked some up for Halloween. That's what I should have had, so I could put it across the screen.
Next year.
That's what I'm talking about. We got see, that's what talk show hosts, this is what we go through. Because if there's nothing going on with someone talking and they don't want to talk that much, we need crickets. So, oh my God, I love it.
This has been amazing. And I want to ask, you know, do you have any final words of wisdom to the audience? Anything you want to leave them with?
Of course. Always smile. You got to smile, man. You have to smile. And even though when you're down, and I kind of talked a little bit about, I talked about when the failures happen. When the failures happen, yes, you're going to actually have your head down. But you're going to smile the next day, right? Take that day to regress, come back up, and you're good. Not everything is going to be positive. You're going to have people that don't like you. You're going to have people that don't really like what you do. Some people, you know, bring out their inner demons to be able to try and bring your inner demons out. And you probably don't even have the demons. You probably have nothing but angels inside of you. You have nothing but happiness inside of you. But sometimes people will try to bring that to you and be like, hey, I'm sad. I'm going to make you sad. And when you do that, that becomes a problem. So I would say to the world, you know, keep shining, you know, keep moving forward. Use common sense, right? Use common sense. We troubleshoot, like I said, I troubleshoot humans all the time. Stay away from, you know, you. Yourself trying to be someone else's friend that really doesn't want to be your friend, or someone that don't want to actually be involved with you. And if you don't want them to, if they don't want to be involved with you, you move on to people that want you to be involved with them. This all of this connects together for you to be a happy person. You know, a lot of people go through this depression, low self-esteem, because they think people don't like them or they don't love them. There's people out there that do love you. It's just by you, how you carry yourself and how you incorporate yourself in someone else's life. So I think that overall, when it comes to stuff like this, the ups and downs, it's all a great connection. I would say, lastly, when it comes to starting a business, you know, if you ever want to start a business, or you ever want to become a talk show host, or if you ever want to actually have, I also have a cooking show too. So, you know, if you ever want to actually have you know, those type of shows, just let you know that I talked about planning, execution, planning, execution, right? You plan for it, everything is coming well, then you execute. If some other pieces that you execute is not okay, you're going to have those. That means that you push those to the side, you fix those, troubleshoot those issues, bring it back into execution if it's going to actually work. If it doesn't, it's fine. That meant that you did not need that at all. So starting a business is not an easy thing. You have to stay consistent. You have to stay strong. You have to stay consistent. You have to be able to know that not everybody's going to like your product. Yes. Not everybody that you think is going to actually follow you. But those people that do love you and they do care about your show or whatever you're doing, they will follow. So stay shining, my gems of the world. Stay shining.
Wonderful, wonderful, powerful words of wisdom. Thank you so much for blessing us with this hour. I know it's going to bring, you know, create so much impact. There's someone that needed to hear this. There's someone that needed to have a chuckle with us. There's someone that needed to, you know, get this knowledge and experience from you. So thank you so much from me and the Meticulous Moments audience for making time for us and, you know, just enlivening this session and just putting a smile on our faces. Thank you so much, Rico.
No problem. I want to give a big shout out to my girl, Juanita Cap. She can use this piece for her promotional, and I'm going to do it because I love the lady. I love her. I don't care if she's in Africa or not. I love her. From virtual coffee to virtual interviews. It's your boy, Rico No Suave, the Rico No Suave Talk Show. Hey, make sure you guys continuously tune in, support my girl, Juanita Cap, on Meticulous Moments, because those words, meticulous, it's a big word. You should be able to use that more often. Let's go.
I love and appreciate you. Thank you so much, my friend. And really, it was just a blast. I had a blast with you. And to the Meticulous Moments audience, I mean, my goodness, make sure you follow Rico on social media, cheer him on, and let's support him in his project as well. And with that, we say good night, and we'll see you in the next session. Goodbye.
Hey. Let's go.
Love it.